Finding love is what I need to light the dark. Hi, I'm Shane Harper, and I play the role of Josh Wheaton in our movie God's Not Dead. Josh is a freshman who enrolls in a philosophy class taught by a very unsympathetic teacher played by Kevin Sorbo. Dr. Radisson demands that all of his students sign a declaration saying they believe that God is dead in order to get a passing grade. Now, Josh refuses to sign the paper and in turn is challenged by the teacher to defend his position that God is alive. If Josh convinces the class that God is not dead, he gets to stay. If he doesn't, he flunks the class.
But there are some flat earthers out there who still consider the existence of a supreme deity to be either necessary or self-evident or both. And with that, as previously announced, I will be turning the podium over to Mr. Wheaton, who will be presenting his case in favor of a supreme celestial dictator, otherwise known as God. Mr. Wheaton, are you ready? Podium is yours.
Atheists say that no one can prove the existence of God, and they're right. But I say no one can disprove that God exists. But the only way to debate this issue is to look at the available evidence, and that's what we're going to do. We're going to put God on trial, with Professor Radisson as the prosecutor, me as the defense attorney, and you as the jury. Most cosmologists now agree that the universe began some 13.7 billion years ago in an event known as the Big Bang. So let's look at theoretical physicist and Nobel Prize winner Steven Weinberg's description of what the Big Bang would have looked like. And since he's an atheist, we can be sure there isn't any believer bias in his description. In the beginning, there was an explosion, and in 3 minutes, 98% of the matter there is or ever will be was produced. We had a universe. For 2,500 years, most scientists agreed with Aristotle on the idea of a steady state universe, that the universe has always existed with no beginning and no end. But the Bible disagreed. In the 1920s, Belgian astronomer George Lemaître, a theist, who's actually also...
What's a theist?
A theist is someone who believes in the existence of God. He said that the entire universe, jumping into existence in a trillionth of a second, out of nothingness, in an unimaginably intense flash of light, is how he would expect the universe to respond if God were to actually utter the command in Genesis 1:3, "Let there be light." In other words, the origin of the universe unfolded exactly how one would expect after reading Genesis, and for 2,500 years, the Bible had it right, and science had it wrong.
I relate to the character in a way that's very personal, because I grew up in church and was caught off guard by certain questions and conversations. I didn't necessarily know how to have a healthy dialogue with people of different backgrounds and beliefs. Now this movie is not going to give definitive answers to everyone, but the goal is to inspire people to have a mind and a heart that prepares you for these conversations. Now, having the courage to take a stand like Josh did is something I really hope people will be inspired by when they see this film. We've got a younger generation who really doesn't know how to defend our faith, and perhaps this movie will inspire our youth and encourage them to really take action and not be afraid to equip themselves. My hope is that pastors, youth ministers, and the faith community will take these teaching tools and educate my generation.
It's been said that evil is atheism's most potent weapon against the Christian faith, and it is. After all, the very existence of evil begs the question. If God is all good, and God is all powerful, why does he allow evil to exist? The answer at its core is remarkably simple. Free will. God allows evil to exist because of free will. From the Christian standpoint, God tolerates evil in this world on a temporary basis, so that one day those who choose to love him freely will dwell with him in heaven, free from the influence of evil, but with their free will intact. In other words, God's intention concerning evil is to one day destroy it.
Well, how convenient. One day, I will get rid of all the evil in the world, but until then, you just have to deal with all the wars and Holocaust, tsunamis, poverty, starvation, and AIDS. Have a nice life. Next, you'll be lecturing us on moral absolutes.
But why not? Professor Radisson, who's clearly an atheist, doesn't believe in moral absolutes, but his course syllabus says he plans to give us an exam during finals weeks. Now, I'm betting that if I manage to get an A in the exam by cheating, he'll suddenly start sounding like a Christian, insisting it's wrong to cheat, that I should have known that. And yet, what basis does he have? If my actions are calculated to help me succeed, then why shouldn't I perform them? For Christians, the fixed point of morality, what constitutes right and wrong, is a straight line that leads directly back to God.
Oh, so you're saying that we need a God to be moral, that a moral atheist is an impossibility.
No, but with no God, there's no real reason to be moral. I mean, there's not even a standard of what moral behavior is.
For Christians, lying, cheating, stealing, in my example, stealing a grade I didn't earn are forbidden. It's a form of theft. But if God does not exist, as Dostoevsky famously pointed out,
if God does not exist, then everything is permissible.
And not only permissible, but pointless. If Professor Radisson is right, then all of this, all of our struggle, our debate, whatever we decide here is meaningless. I mean, our lives and ultimately our deaths are of no more consequence than that of a goldfish.
Well, this is ridiculous. So after all your talk, you're saying that it all comes down to a choice. Believe or don't believe.
That's right. That's all there is. That's all there's ever been. The only difference between your position and my position is that you take away their choice. You demand that they choose the box marked, I don't believe.
Yes, because I want to free them. Because religion is like a... It's like a mind virus that parents have passed on down to their children. And Christianity is the worst virus of all. It slowly creeps into our lives when we're weak or sick or helpless.
So religion is like a disease?
Yes. Yes, it infects everything. It's the enemy of reason.
Reason? Professor, you left reason a long time ago. What you're teaching here isn't philosophy. It's not even atheism anymore. What you're teaching is anti-theism. It's not enough that you don't believe. You need all of us to not believe with you.
Why don't you admit the truth? You just want to ensnare them in your primitive superstition.
What I want is for them to make their own choice. That's what God wants.
You have no idea how much I'm going to enjoy failing you.
Yeah, but who are you really looking to fail, Professor? Me? Or God? Do you hate God?
It's not even a question.
Okay. Why do you hate God?
This is ridiculous.
Why do you hate God? Answer the question. You've seen the science and the arguments. Science supports his existence. You know the truth. So why do you hate him? Why? It's a very simple question, Professor. Why do you hate God?
Thanks for letting me share my story and for watching a few scenes from God's Not Dead. Our hope is that this movie will be a valuable resource and ministry tool that you can use. Because God's not dead. He's surely alive.